So I guess today what I want to talk about, I mean, the talk might be a little disjoint because I want to cover sort of two things. Both of these are nonlinear aspects of geophysical fluid dynamics. The first is the formation of jets. And that is, we try to see whether we can understand jet formation from the perspective of the QG equations that we derived, right? And once we go through this, the second part that I want to come to is actually real atmospheric turbulence. And here is where we will come to some pictures of observations of, let's say, spectra and so on in the real atmosphere. And then, of course, can we understand these in terms of rotating and stratified turbulence or in terms of shallow water turbulence and so on, right? So the picture is that, see, till now I've been showing you maps that are sort of average, right? We take data for the whole month or for a couple of days. We smoothen it out, and then we see that geostrophic balance and so on holds quite well. Our linear theory works quite well. But if you take an instantaneous picture of the atmosphere, say, for example, all the ocean, that is the picture I showed you last time of the Kuroshio current, you see that there's some semblance of a current, but there are a lot of eddies along with the flow. So if you want to understand what is happening at any given time, you're quite sure that you will have to deal with the nonlinear problem, right? So that is going to be our starting point. So did the lectures on turbulence cover 2D turbulence? Two-dimensional turbulence, was that spoken about? Yes? Okay. A little bit. So let me just give a sketch of what we expect from 2D. And it turns out that 2D is very different from 3D. And that's why I'll just give you a small sketch of it, right? So if we say that we are in a 2D system, our evolution equation is very simply this over here, right? Where omega is the vorticity, which can be given as the Laplacian of a stream function. This is a 2D incompressible system, so partial u, partial x, partial v, partial y is equal to zero. And essentially, the dynamics is contained in the evolution of the vorticity. And of course, note, this is two-dimensional, so this is just partial x and partial y, just two parts over here, right? Now, this is, of course, the material conservation of vorticity. And associated with this, one can immediately write down a global conservation of law of the form. That is, if you take the quantity omega squared, you integrate it over the entire domain, you'll find that this guy remains a constant, and this is known as the entropy, right? So the distinction between 2 and 3D fluids is that this guy, of course, conserves the integral of u squared plus v squared over the entire domain. That is just the energy. In addition to that, it also conserves entropy. So given these dual constraints, you have a distinctly different character to the motion of two-dimensional turbulence as compared to 3D turbulence. And this was investigated in detail, I guess, beginning from the 50s and so on. In fact, there are some very famous physicists who are associated with 2D turbulence, people like T.D. Lee and so on. But I guess the most concrete picture came out in the 60s by the work of Kraikkonen. And essentially, he built upon the kind of ideas that Kolmogorov had put forth for inertial ranges and cascades and so forth, and applied them to this problem, taking into account the fact that you have constraints of this kind, or an additional constraint of this kind. And the picture that comes up qualitatively is something like this. That is, if you take a 2D fluid, and now this is my energy spectrum, so I'm going to go to wave number space, and if you force it, let's say at some wave number KF over here, right? So in 3D, what do you expect? You expect if you inject energy over here, it's basically going to flow downscale and be dissipated, right? That's the picture you get in 3D. But in 2D, remarkably, what you get is a picture of this kind, where basically you have two different spectra that lie on either side of the forcing. Here, you get an inverse transfer of energy. So it's a very peculiar situation. In physical space, if I take a 2D problem, I start with an isotropic random initial condition and just let it go. Let's say I don't force it. you wait for a certain amount of time, what you will find is the spontaneous formation of large-scale coherent structures. That is, physically, energy is moving up, up, up to bigger and bigger scales. That's exactly what this guy is showing you. That is, energy tends to be transferred to larger scales. And if you do a dimensional analysis, you find that, once again, the spectrum of this guy goes as k raised to minus 5/3. Whereas, on this side, you actually get something known as an entropy transfer to small scales. Now note that because energy is going up, this doesn't mean all the energy is going up. Predominantly, energy goes up. A certain amount of energy does go downscale. In the same way, this is predominantly an entropy transfer to small scales, but some amount of entropy is going up, right? And if you do a dimensional analysis over here, you will find that the power law you get is k raised to minus 3. So basically, you force here, you get two kinds of power laws. And in fact, the picture that comes along in terms of fluxes is something you should always keep in mind. So if I take this to be my kf, and let's say this is the energy flux. So at kf, what you find is your energy flux is basically something of this kind. So below this guy, you have a negative transfer, that is, you have a negative energy flux going to large scales. And of course, you expect this guy to be constant over some range, which is going to be your inertial range over here. In the same way, if you look at the entropy flux, you get something of this kind. And once again, you expect this guy to be constant for a small range here, which you would call the inertial range, right? So this is the picture that goes with this. And in fact, if you look at very modern numerical simulations of 2D turbulence, that's exactly what you get. So this is a review paper in 2012 by Boffetta and Ecchi. And what they have, so first of all, you note the numbers. These simulations, the largest one is done at 32,000 squared. It's a humongously large resolution. They can go down to very, very small dissipation with that. And what you see is exactly the picture that is painted here. Oh, sorry. So they force here. So you see a small peak, which is where the forcing is. Above this, you have a slightly shallow spectrum that's going as k raised to minus 5/3. Below this, that is at smaller scales, you have a k raised to minus 3. In terms of the energy flux, you have a large inverse flux, and maybe a small forward flux over here. Exactly the opposite for the entropy flux, maybe a small inverse over here, and a large forward over here, right? So this picture is basically what was deduced by Kraikanen in his paper. I guess this paper is 1967 in Physics of Fluids, and that seems to be more or less what happens over here, right? Now, right. So the question is, what happens if I move this from a 2D system to a QG system? Because we want to understand the turbulence of a QG system. So let me. I guess I'll just rub this. And so this was 2D. Now note that there is no anisotropy here, right? These coherent structures that are formed are perfectly isotropic. There's no preference of x or y, right? So in 2D turbulence, doesn't care whether it's kx or ky. So the question is this symmetry broken by qg, right? So what was our qg equation? Well, we said d by dt, Laplacian of psi minus psi by ld squared plus is equal to 0, right? So let's make things easy and let's put LD equal to infinity. This makes things a little easier. What does this imply? Where did the LD come from? It was basically related to the first order divergence. So now what I'm saying is my flow is equal to 0, but of course, can be non-zero. So it's basically incompressible to a higher order. That's what this limit means over here, right? So I set this guy over here. So my equation becomes much easier. I just have a Laplacian of psi plus beta, partial psi, partial x, is equal to 0. So you compare this with the 2D equation, everything seems same, excepting you have this extra term over here. So can this create any problems for us, or can it change the character of these things over here? So let's see. What we do is we write this equation down in Fourier space. Was the Navier-Stokes equation transformed to Fourier space in the turbulence class? Yes? Good. Because doing the transform is not difficult, it's just tedious, and I don't want to spend time, and I'll probably get it wrong if I try to do it on the board. So I'll just write down what you get. So if you take this guy, and what you're going to say is, you're going to transform to Fourier space. So I'm going to take my psi to be equal to some function psi kt, and I'm going to keep this form over here. You could drop this, because this can be as general as it wants. I'm just keeping this as a prefactor, because, or a post-factor, because it makes things a little easy in my in the schematic that I'm going to show you. So you take this, right? What is this equation? The only thing you have to worry about is the nonlinear term, because that becomes a convolution in Fourier space, right? So your term u partial x, this is going to be a convolution. And of course, u is equal to minus partial psi partial y. So you have to remember this, plug this guy in, and the kind of equation you will get is basically okay, let me write this as over here, and your CKPQ is your nonlinear term, which, if I remember correctly, takes the form p squared minus q squared. So you can do this calculation. It's a nice exercise to try out. Basically, you're just taking this guy over here, applying this over here, and using convolution. That's all. That's what, and you'll end up with this. The important part is that if I just consider the 2D equation over here, you will basically get the same Fourier transform, except this guy will be missing, because there is no dispersive term. This is the dispersive term that you get over here. So this guy will be missing the pure 2D problem. In QG, this phase factor is extra in QG, right? So this will be missing if you do the transform for just d by dt of Laplacian psi is equal to 0, right? Now the question is, what does this do to the dynamics? So the dynamics is right here, right? This is the nonlinear dynamics right here. So what is this guy going to do to these nonlinear terms? And you can clearly see the form of this guy. What is the form of this guy? It's of the form e raised to I phi t, right? What are these integrals in time, these functions in time? They're also oscillating in time. If I integrate for some time, what's going to happen? They're likely to cancel out, right? So wherever phi is non-zero, an integral of this for a certain amount of time is going to dampen your nonlinearity. Your nonlinear term might be very strong, but it is modulated by this exponential over here. So this leads to a classification of nonlinear interactions in the following manner. That is, the most important ones are obviously those for which phi is equal to 0, right? Which are those interactions? Those are interactions for which sigma p plus sigma q plus us is equal to sigma of k. These are nothing but resonant interactions. Of course, you have the condition with it that k is equal to p plus q. That has to be satisfied to form triad. So the strongest interactions are those for which this phi goes away, and those are nothing but purely resonant interactions. So these are called resonances over here. And in fact, if I write down this equation in non-dimensional form, you'll find that you will get a prefactor here, which will be something like the Rossby number. So you can define something known as near resonances, where the sum of these guys is of the order of the Rossby number, right? And then there are the things that are non-resonant, where the sum of these guys is much greater than the Rossby number. So you have three hierarchies here. For the time being, let's just restrict ourselves to these guys. That is, at first order, you say that, well, the nonlinear dynamics is essentially the same, but the nonlinearity is being scrambled by these phase factors. Certain classes of interactions, which are resonant, do not have a scrambling. So those are likely to be the most strong nonlinear interactions. So we focus our attention on those, and we say, what is the dynamics that's given by these guys, right? And this is actually a very interesting question in mathematics, right? Try to solve this for KPQ. It's a very underdetermined system, right? Because what do we have? We require kx is equal to px plus qx. We require ky to be equal to py plus qqy. And I require sigma of k to be equal to sigma of p plus sigma of q. I only have three equations over here, but I have kx, px, qx as my unknowns. And to solve this guy over here is going to be a fairly challenging problem, especially if you, let's say, go from the QG equation to, say, the stratified problem or the rotating stratified problem. These sets of resonances start becoming more and more convoluted. And in fact, one of the routes to proving the regularity of these equations comes from focusing attention on these guys. That is, if you look at the textbook Atmosphere Ocean Fluid Dynamics and the chapter by Babin, Mahalov, and so on, what they say is, consider this system. Now take the limit of very rapid rotation, right? So as you take the limit of more and more rapid rotation, these guys become more and more prominent. That is, the non-resonant interactions become weaker and weaker, and everything is controlled very strongly by these guys. Can you prove that the system remains regular only by considering these guys? So these are the kinds of questions these mathematicians ask. And there's a whole line of work that has gone on trying to prove various classes of regularity theorems for the stratified problem, the rotating stratified problem, based on this kind of approach. But that is well beyond my scope right now. What we'll focus on is, what does this imply for the isotropy? And it's very simple. This was recognized by Rhines. He said, let's look at resonant interactions in the QG system. Right? So this was Rhines. In the mid-1970s, so he said, okay, let's examine resonances, and plus you add in the fact that the nonlinear term, when it becomes comparable to the dispersive term, he said that there should be a qualitative change in the character of the flow. That is, what is the strength of this guy? This is this term. What is this term? Beta partial psi partial x, right? So if I equate these two guys over here, you can immediately come up with a length scale u by beta. So he said this isotropic picture of things moving up is when this guy controls the flow, when the dispersive term is not playing much of a role. So up to this scale, the picture that you have from 2D turbulence should work fine. But beyond a certain scale, you have the fact that these two guys are essentially of the same strength, and that's where the waves should come into the picture. And as soon as the waves come into the picture, we have to start looking at what this implies, right? So now let's see. If you look at waves, we know that energy is going to large scales, right? Now, there's a theorem by Hasselmann, which is in 1966 or so, which says that if you consider any triad, then energy is transferred to the wave vector with smallest frequency. And this is, in fact, just a continuation of a simple intuitive idea, that is, if u is essentially omega is essentially u times k. So if you take Taylor's hypothesis, you're basically saying that if you go to larger and larger scales, k is becoming smaller and smaller. You expect the frequency to also become smaller and smaller. What Hasselman did is, he did not assume this. He said for any general triad, we can actually prove that if you consider the linear stability of these triads, the one that becomes unstable is the one that has the smallest frequency. So energy is transferred to the smallest frequency. So what do you have? You have constraint number one, that is, energy has to go to large scales. You have constraint number two, that energy also has to go to smaller frequencies, right? Now, what Rhines is saying is that beyond this length scale, the energy is essentially going to go into waves. That is, the Rossby waves are going to play a role. So we have to look at the frequency of Rossby waves and see if we can satisfy this constraint. What is the frequency of Rossby waves? You have sigma is equal to minus beta kx upon, you have your k squared. So I've taken LD to be infinity, so it's just a k squared, right? Now, oh, let me call that a capital K squared. Now he said, assume that the flow remains isotropic. What does that mean? That means kx is approximately the same as ky. So this guy becomes minus beta by k, and you're in a problem. Right? Because you've got a beta by k. So if you just take the magnitude of this guy, basically what is happening is as energy tends to go to smaller and smaller scales, if you are actually transferring energy amongst Rossby waves, the energy is actually going to go to larger frequencies, not to smaller frequencies. So you cannot satisfy both these constraints if you remain isotropic. You have to break the isotropy of the problem beyond this scale over here, and the way in which you break it, if you just do the algebra, is to make kx by ky less than 1. That is, you transfer to small scales in kx, that is, you get very, or sorry, transfer to small wave numbers in kx, that is, you get large scales in x, but small scales in y. So basically, you destroy the isotropy of the problem, and physical space, if initially your eddies look like this, so this is your ly, and this is your LX, what is going to happen is these eddies are going to grow. Once they reach a scale of LR, you're going to start seeing them take a shape of this kind, where your length scale in X will be large, but the length scale in Y will remain the same as it is. So your ratio KX by KY will be much less than 1. And of course, if my length scale here is small, the gradient in this direction is going to be large. Gradient in this direction is large is a jet, right? Because the jet is nothing but partial respect to y of this guy. So you spontaneously get a jet-like flow. So this qualitative argument followed these two constraints and the fact that you have a transition at some point. He said, everything is fine for 2D turbulence. Things go up isotropically. But at some stage, these two terms are going to be of the same strength. Once they become of the same strength, you will get a transfer of energy into zonal flows. So let's see. And that is essentially a jet. So that would be a very basic way in which a beta plane equation would spontaneously generate a jet from isotropic forcing. Let's see if that works. This is a very, I guess this is not a very nice or a very clear picture, but this is a set of simulations done by Maltrude and Wallace. This is the same Wallace whose textbook that we are using. And what he's done here is focus only on the first one. So they forced this QG on a beta plane at some scale. This is KF, okay? So you see the small peak. And energy tends to go up. In fact, this line is almost minus 5/3, okay? But the line that's below is the spectrum with respect to Y. The line that's above is the spectrum with respect to KX. So what happens beyond a certain scale, and that scale is exactly called K beta, and that is your this guy over here. This is your K beta. Beyond that, oh, what happened here? So beyond your K beta, you start seeing that you really don't have a spectrum of any kind, but energy seems to have piled up in the zonal wave numbers. And in fact, if you look at a physical space picture of this, this is nothing but your jet, that the energy is just sitting at some scale, below which you have a nice Papa power law, right? Now, this was revisited by, I mean, this has been done by a million people, QG turbulence, and QG turbulence is still by no means a completely settled problem. This picture that I'm showing you is basically correct. But the details that come up, let's say, for example, you put in friction. What happens? does this cascade get halted at some stage if you have large-scale drag? What kind of friction? Do you put Ekman friction? Do you put drag? Does that affect the spectrum? These are things that people have been doing, are still doing. We will not even come near them right now. We'll just take the simple picture over here. This is a more recent simulation by Danilov. And you basically see the same photo. That is, you get these jets that form in the domain. This is the vorticity of the flow. And if you look at the spectra, the picture changes slightly. So you see the spectrum, this isotropic spectrum scales very closely as -5/3. And in fact, this is very close to the spectrum of KY. But what happens is the KX spectrum gets completely destroyed to a large extent. That is just reflecting the fact that you have coherent jets. So if you have a coherent structure that goes on for a very long, long length scale, it's not going to have a power law kind of a spectrum. It's going to have more of a spectrum that seems to be over here. But if you join the peaks of this guy, you do tend to see some universality. And there's a claim that this envelope goes as k raised to -5, which was also hypothesized by Rhines in that thing. But I'm not sure how robust these are with respect to the numerics that people have done. But this is what I guess the state of the art is, that you do see an isotropic spectrum that seems like a -5/3. But the KY and the KX are very different, and the KX really shows you multiple peaks over here, right? What do I have? Okay, now I don't want to go to that yet. Okay. Do I have anything else? No. So do you have any questions on this? Because I want to move to the next block of topics, which is atmospheric turbulence. So any questions on this part? Excuse me, I didn't hear. Huh. Exactly. So what we are saying is we have a phase factor over here, which is of the kind e raised to I phi t, right? So if you, and this was, so this is d is equal to this, right? So if you try to propagate psi in time, so you integrate with respect to time, you're going to get an integral of this kind, right, with some pre-factors. But the integral of this kind, where you have things that are going up and down in time, is likely to cancel out, right, over a sufficiently long period of time. It will only not cancel out if phi is equal to 0. That is, there is no oscillation. So what you say is that the class of interactions where phi is equal to 0, which is precisely these guys, these are likely to be the strongest non-linear terms. The ones where this guy is small will be next. The ones where this phase factor oscillates very rapidly are likely to play a very, very small role in the dynamics. So that is the hierarchy you create between resonances, what is called near resonances, and things that are far from resonance. Okay? So a good reference for this, once again, is, I guess this book is not very well known. It's a book by a bunch of authors, Anil et al., which is more on plasma physics. But their introductory chapter is basically on resonances, non-resonances, near resonances, and a whole class of things of that kind in a very general setting. Then they move off to plasma physics, but the initial part of the book, the first chapter, is very much on non-linear dispersive partial differential equation, and this is the kind of stuff they end up with. Okay? So what Ryan said is that for the beta plane equations, you have two constraints. The first constraint is that energy is going to large scale, which is the same as pure 2D turbulence, right? The second constraint, which is also shared by 2D turbulence, is that energy is going to small frequencies. But in 2D turbulence, you don't have any other waves. The only waves that you can sort of generate, or the only frequency you have, is by transforming U to K by Taylor's hypothesis. So of course, if K becomes small, omega is going to become small, so it's not really an additional constraint, right? On the other hand, what Ryan said is that in the QG system, the kind of dispersion relation you have to satisfy is actually the dispersion relation of Rossby waves. So you need energy to go to smaller frequencies in Rossby waves, right? So these are the two constraints. Energy goes to large scales, small frequencies, and Rossby waves. Now, you write down the Rossby wave dispersion relation. If you assume that the flow is isotropic, Kx is the same as Ky, so this is just beta by K. But that's where you get into trouble, right? Because K is becoming smaller and smaller, so this guy is going to become larger. So you can't satisfy these two guys if kx remains the same as ky. So the only way to get around it is to say that kx has to become different from ky. And precisely if you do this over here, substitute this here, you'll find that you will go to smaller and smaller kx while maintaining this guy, then you will also go to smaller and smaller frequency. So you satisfy both the constraints, but the net result is that the flow becomes anisotropic. That is, from this state, you go to this state. Is that okay? Yeah. Right. So let's move to the second part. So the second part starts off with an observation. So this is, I guess, a paper that has troubled a lot of people, and this is something that people, I guess, they still don't have an answer to these spectra. There are a lot of theories. Depending on whom you ask, they have their favorite theory, but so on. What is this? This is a measurement of atmospheric turbulence done in the 1980s by Nystrom and Gage. What they did was they asked commercial flights to actually keep a device on the wings which would measure the velocities that the plane encountered. So once the plane took off, they would start recording while it was flying up in the troposphere, and then they would shut it off. And this was based on thousands of flights, and they computed the power spectra of what you get. So this is basically the power spectrum of the wind, the meridional and the zonal direction, and this is of temperature. The most interesting thing that people saw was, so this scale, I guess this is about 10,000 kilometers, this is 1,000 kilometers. So from about 5,000 kilometers to about, say, 500 meters or so, you have a spectrum that scales approximately as k^-3. It's a very steep spectrum. But beyond about 500 meters, the spectrum seems to become a little shallower and actually goes very close to k^-5/3. And that goes all the way from, say, 500 meters to about, let's say, 50 meters or so, right? The same is true for the other direction wind and also for the temperature. We'll not really worry about this. If you just look at the zonal wind, you see this break. So let me erase this stuff. Right. So basically, if you see, the sketch is, you have a scale of about 5,000 kilometers, a scale of about 500 kilometers, let's say a scale of about 50 meters. And what you see is, you have a -5/3 here, and you have a -3 over here. The question is, and this is E of K. So the question is, can you explain these two spectra in the transition based on, let's say, rotating stratified turbulence or QG theory, right? The problem is QG theory and 2D turbulence have exactly the opposite spectrum, right? If you take what we had in, you have this as your KF, you see minus and -5/3. That is, in 2D turbulence, -5/3 goes up, -3 comes down. So on the shallower side, or sorry, the smaller side, you have a steeper spectrum, right? Which is basically a flip of this guy. So it can't be directly 2D turbulence. And there's been a lot of speculation on what this is. Let me see what I have next. Yeah. So this should K really. I'm just saying translated to physical space, it's about 5,000. You're right, this is K. I'm just saying this is approximately 5,000 kilometers, right? So the first sort of hypothesis that came up by Lilly and co-workers was that they said this is a spectrum that can be explained by the presence of two sources. So you take a two-dimensional fluid and you force it over here, and you force it over here, right? And so what will happen, you force it over here, you get an inverse transfer that goes as by -5/3. You force it at large scales, this is basically the planetary scale, so nothing can go up. This is an entropy cascade over here. So this is also, this is an entropy over here, this is an energy over here. The two meet at some point, and that's why you get a transition. It's a perfectly viable hypothesis, except for the fact that around the scale of 50 or so kilometers, the atmosphere really isn't two-dimensional. because the height of the domain is pretty much the same as a 50 kilometers width. So it's very difficult to justify a 2D fluid at this kind of a scale. That's the first problem. The second thing is, what is the source? That is physically, the source at large scales is basically baroclinic instability. That is what the unstable waves at that scale are putting in energy into the system at a scale of about 5,000 kilometers. But what is the source here? You need really strong source at a very, very small scale, 50 kilometers. There is really no such source that one can think of. So that becomes the second problem. And the final problem that comes up is people actually revisited this data and computed the fluxes. Right? Because see, the energy spectrum by itself is non-unique. You need a flux with it to pin down the physics. You can draw a spectrum, you can't put a physics with it till you know the direction in which energy is going. Right? A minus 5/3 could be 3D forward cascade or a 2D inverse cascade. Unless you plot the flux, you're not going to know what you're talking about. Right? So when people plotted the fluxes, they saw that the picture is essentially like this. So this is something that is done very recently by taking these very fine scale but global models of the atmosphere, and what is plotted is precisely the energy flux, right? So you focus. So this is a mixture of data. So I guess this plot I'm showing is from a model, and they have it from reanalysis also, which is, again, data plus model. But the same guys, Lindborg and so on, in the early 2000, actually went back to the data set of Nestrom and Gage. Unfortunately, there you only have 1D data, right? You have transects. You can't compute fluxes. But what you can compute are structure functions. So the third-order structure function will tell you something about the sign of the energy flux. So they did that computation, and it comes in line with what they're showing over here, right? So the picture that comes up is, so let's look at the kinetic energy, that's pi k, right? So pi k is basically going inverse, crosses over to being positive. So you have an inverse transfer at large scales and a forward transfer at small scales. So clearly this minus 5/3 is a forward transfer of energy. It's not an inverse transfer of energy. So this cannot be a 2D cascade going up. It has to be something that is bringing energy to small scales, right? The second thing is, this definitely could be an entropy cascade regime, where your energy is going upscale and your entropy is coming down. So that is what this supports. That at large scales, you do have an inverse transfer. The most interesting part about this plot are actually these two dotted lines over here. So what these guys have done is, now they've taken the data and split it, do a Helmholtz decomposition into the divergent part and the rotational part, right? Look at the rotational part. The dotted line over here is the rotational energy flux. That essentially always stays negative. It controls the total energy flux at large scales, and then it becomes extremely small. Whereas the dashed line is the divergent flux. That is very small at large scales, but becomes really large over here and becomes a total. So the picture that comes up from this is that if you take a system that has rotational and divergent mode, the divergent modes are the ones that are going in the forward direction. The rotational modes are the ones that are going in the inverse direction. And the rotational modes are precisely QG, right? That is your rotational mode. It has no divergence associated with it, right? So, but the divergent part are those waves we filtered out, the inertia gravity waves. So QG spectrum will never get that divergent part of the stuff that's going on. You have to move to something that has the divergent part, let's say the shallow water equations, or you could move to the fully compressible rotating stratified problem that would contain this thing. And the same kind of picture comes again if you look at so this is by looking at the spectra from various kinds of models. So once again, I can't really remember what this AN and FC mean. They're two different kinds of very high resolution models. The interesting thing to look at is this plot. What they've shown here are the power spectrum of the rotational part and the divergent part. So the rotational part is the steep guy that's coming here. The divergent part is the shallow guy, and they intersect at some point. So the picture that comes up is, if you take the power spectrum of the rotational modes, you get a -3. This is nothing but your forward potential entropy cascade or an inverse energy cascade for the QG system. Whereas if you plot the power spectrum of the divergent modes, you get something that's, let's say, k raised to -β, where beta is some number. There's really no theory to predict what this beta is. It seems to be close to minus 5/3, but I don't know of any theory that can show that it's actually minus 5/3. But the point being that they cross at some scale. That is, beyond a certain small scale, the divergent motions start becoming become dominant. At large scales, the rotational motion is dominant. This large scale motion is basically in geostrophic balance. That's exactly what we have seen, that for large scales where rotation starts becoming very important, you basically get QG theory. That's where you get the spectrum of QG turbulence, because you're forcing only over here. This is the only real force that you have, because you have a system that is baroclinically unstable. It's generating baroclinic waves at this large scale of about 5,000 kilometers. That's pretty much the predominant source that you have. What happens? Well, here you see the expression of QG, but beyond a certain point, it's the divergent modes that take over, right? And that's why you get a spectrum that has a naturally a break of this kind. That is, if you look at the total spectrum, it goes here, and then it becomes slightly shallow. So you have a minus 3 to a minus something transition. Whether it's minus 5/3 or not is not very clear. And you can check the... So this is actually a map that people... Because see, the confusion in this has been a lot of people claim that the divergent part over here is too small as compared to the rotational part. This entire spectrum has to be given by the rotational modes themselves. So the other line of inquiry that tries to explain this spectrum is purely based on QG theory, where the claim is that the divergent part will never be strong enough to match the rotational part. And in fact, everything should be explained. The transition should be explained by some modification of QG itself. Right? And there are very, very credible works along those lines. This is not to say they're wrong or anything. That is another line of possible this thing. But what these guys did, they said, well, let's actually map what the divergent field looks like and what is its strength. And you can see the number. It's about 10 raised to minus 4. That is comparable to F in the mid-latitudes. Right? So this is not a small number that you get as the divergence in the flow. And furthermore, you see its scale. There's really no large-scale structure. Right? So its power spectrum is going to be something that's shallow, but it's going to be dominant at small scales, not at very large scales. Right? And that's precisely what you get with this kind of a picture over here. That is, the divergent modes come here, the rotational modes come here. So the total spectrum is something of this kind. And in fact, if you go back to trying to explain this from your idealized dynamics, these were some of the early experiments done on shallow water turbulence, where you have both rotational modes and a divergent mode. And precisely that's what you see. See the total energy. Now, the resolution here is not particularly good. You see the total energy is a solid line. The rotational modes are the dashed line over here. And the dot dash is the... is the inertia gravity wave. And at some point, the inertia gravity waves start dominating over this, and they have a much shallower spectrum. In fact, these lines here are -3 and -3 and -5/5/3. So you start seeing that the overall spectrum gets a transition at some stage, right? And this has been looked at. This is an example from 3D rotating stratified turbulence. You take the Business system, make it rotate. That's exactly what you see. You start off with initial data that's distributed everywhere as k raised to minus 5/3. You plot the power spectrum in the rotational modes as a function of time. And when the system reaches equilibrium, the rotational modes are giving you a very clear -3 spectrum, whereas if you plot the inertia gravity waves, you start with a -5/3, but it seems as though they come down to -1, right? And people have tried to repeat this experiment, and see the difference between going from here to here is not very large. So, and there's really no theory to predict what this guy is going to be. There is some theory to go along with a -1 over here, which connects to the driving of a passive tracer by a smooth flow. Because what is the wave mode? If you actually take the wave mode to be decoupled from the rotational mode, then the wave modes at small scales are being driven by a large scale rotational flow. This is nothing but the bachelor problem of a passive tracer. You have a large scale flow that's driving a small scale tracer. You expect a k raised to -1 spectrum. So there is some reason to believe that wave modes in the limit of very rapid rotation and stratification will actually go to k raised to -1, where they don't really couple with the vertical modes at all, or the rotational mode. But that is a limiting case, right? So whether the spectrum is going to be between 1 and -5/3 is something that's still not very clear. But this has been repeated by a lot of guys. Here's another example. You have this is your rotational spectrum that goes as minus 3. In this case, you have your wave spectrum that's close to a -5/3, and the total energy seems to show this kind of a transition over here. So these things keep coming up, and one of the, I guess, I would not say this is the answer, but one hypothesis is that rotating plus stratified turbulence, that is, rotational modes plus divergent modes, they sum up to give you this spectrum over here, right? Now, people have gone ahead and measured the strength of the divergent motion and the rotational motion at this scale, and basically the fights are at that level, is that which is stronger, right? Now, it's difficult to estimate these guys, first of all, from the data that you have, the real data, because real data that you have is really point measurements or track measurements. To estimate divergence is not easy, but it seems as though the claim for this not being true is that both of these are of equal magnitude beyond a certain scale. This guy never really dominates the divergent mode, so you can't claim that the spectrum at small scales is the divergent spectrum. That is the argument against this kind of a theory, right? So, but this is a possibility, is what I would say. So, do I have, I have only 10 minutes. Okay, I wanted to go to something else. What I'll do is maybe, because this will require more, so what should I do? I'll require more than 10 minutes for this. Should I do this after the lunch break or something? As a tutorial? So basically what I want to show you is that this jet formation and so on, we have looked at it as a problem in turbulence. Atmospheric physicists actually look at it from a very different point of view. And there are actually multiple views that they have, one of which is known as the mixing of potential vorticity, right? So, and Jean-Luc is not here yet, so I guess, so mixing and stirring is his cup of coffee, I guess. So you look at the equation. So this is the PV equation you have over here, right? And this is a very unique equation, right? Because the PV is being mixed by the flow. But the PV determines the flow, right? Because the PV is nothing but the Laplacian of the stream function. So the PV determines the flow, but it is being mixed by the flow. So it's a very, very odd kind of a problem. And what you expect from this is something that a theory known as PV homogenization, which naturally actually gives you jets, right? So that is one viewpoint that people have of jets, which is complementary to this stuff. The other viewpoint is to look at momentum fluxes, right? So what people for a long time in atmospheric physics have done is they have decomposed a given field into a zonal mean and eddy, right? And now you consider the influences of the eddies, the nonlinear influences of the eddies on the mean flow. And you can write down, let me just, to advertise what's going to be derived, you can write an equation of this form, right? Where I have split u is equal to u bar plus u prime, where this is a zonal average, and this is the eddy or the departure from the zonal mean. If you plug this into your governing equations, make the assumptions of incompressibility, you can derive an equation of this form, which says a zonal mean flow is driven by the eddy momentum flux, right? So this is a nonlinear term, and not only the eddy momentum flux, it's convergence. So as soon as you have the convergence of eddy momentum flux, you are going to get a minus sign here, so this will become a plus, and this is going to be driven in the forward direction. So to form jet, you actually need partial respect to y of this to be to be negative. And we can immediately show this from a very, very simple thought experiment of taking a domain, which is on a middle latitude beta plane, putting a random perturbation. What do you expect? You expect Rossby waves to be generated. Rossby waves have to transport energy away from the source. If you impose an energy transport away from the source, you will immediately see that the momentum flux is actually toward the source, and you get a jet. So you immediately see that the nonlinear momentum flux that you get from a Rossby wave also drives a jet. And that is a complementary view to the turbulence, because this is nothing but the turbulence that you will judge and underrate. So basically, atmospheric physicists like to look at things from this point of view. So I'd like to show that, because maybe you won't be familiar with it, right? And so in the tutorial, we'll try to derive this guy, and you can actually try to derive this for the full water equations also, and this leads to something very very beautiful called the transformed Eulerian mean theory of fluid dynamics. This has been done in the 70s and 80s by a lot of PPP natural science. So I hope we can get to a part of that, right? So I'll stop here. Of course, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. And we'll pick up from here. That is another view of jets and so on in the tutorial. Okay? Yeah. I didn't hear you. What? So that's also, in any given field, you can split it into a divergent part and a rotational part, right? Exactly. So that's all we are doing. We are saying you take your field and you just split it into these two parts. But of course, the rotational part is going to be the quasi-geostrophic part because that is what QG does, right? So it, all the four sources coming from paraclinic instability over here, right? So this is basically forcing the entire system. Some of it projects onto the rotational part. Some of it goes onto the divergent part. There's I don't think there would be any exclusive source for just the divergent forcing. Though when you're in the tropics, you could consider things like moist convection, which is say related to convergence and divergence, that being a sole force sourcing for only the divergent part, right? But this is more of a picture for the mid latitudes. Zonal flow what? Just in the zonal direction. U. Our Cartesian system is always in this direction, right? So my x is basically in the zonal direction. So when I say u, I mean a flow in the zonal direction that's in the x direction. That's it. No, it's not that it's only driven by the Earth's rotation. All we are saying is you take all the fields that you have, you can decompose them into a rotational part and a divergent part. No. So if you even did have a Coriolis force, so for example, if you do Navier-Stokes in a box with a compressible term, you will get a rotational and a divergent part, right? So even if it's not rotating. So there's no reason that the rotation is the only sole cause for it. The rotation makes it a little more dominant because you get QG theory, which is essentially rotational dynamics. So it gives you, it enhances the strength of that guy, especially at large scales where the rotation is important. Large scales and small, say, velocity fields where the Rossby number is small, it enhances that strength, right? And that's exactly why you see the spectrum. This has the largest NN energy over here, that it's coming crashing down very quickly. This has a much small, a smaller NN energy, right? Anything else? Okay, thanks.